Boom. Hey, all you sports fans out there in the tubosphere. Welcome to the One Man Sports Rant, Gen 2.0. I am your host, Will, the alternative ESPN, or in this case, NBC, Sports Thrill, winding down our Olympics-only format coverage. So what is the OMSR Gen 2.0? Well, it's not me flapping my gums for 15 minutes. Well, it's not a highlight reel for 15 minutes either. What it is, we took the lessons learned from Generation 1, we tried to incorporate it into, you know, interesting talk, if not entertaining, but definitely in a context you won't hear on, any other network, because we don't have to answer to the network, the sponsors, or to the producers slash gatekeepers. And so I realize 15 minutes may not be your cup of tea, so I'll give you a spoiler alert. You can always fast forward 6 to 10 minutes to the slightly longer highlight reel. So it is an OMSR specialty to get to the heart of the matter, vis-a-vis the talk and the video highlights to the sports subject being discussed. We use the highlights to sort of back up the premise within the talk. And we have a knack for timing things up and covering like the first ever this or the most that, least whatever the case may have been that makes that particular sporting event singular in its historical nature. Now, like in Generation 1, we did over 200 shows. And that sort of knack proved well, because it's not like we cover, and I should say more rather, there are a few people involved with this project. But from time to time, I go back and forth. I know it sounds oxymoronic. Not every sporting event in any particular sport, but the things that are singular in nature, like big time top five matchups in basketball or football, you know, college sports are our specialty. But I also, you know, caught the Centennial Indy and Baylor's first Heisman Trophy, and, you know, NBA playoffs, things of this nature. The one time I tried to do a little bitty, itty bitty vignette as to how the Super Bowl ended, the NFL came a calling and dinged me in back in Generation 1. I spoke to the gal at NFL Properties LLC in New York. She flat out told me they do not, nor ever will, give permission to anyone to do anything of that sort of nature, even if it's only 10 seconds long. So don't go there, because they will find you. That's all they do, all day, is apparently look for videos on all the social networking sites. And I was like, okay, well that sounds like a tough job. And then the NCAA this year, with the content ID, not serious, as serious as a ding, came up. Some of the tournament games I'd cover, but the majority not. So I was like, what is going on here? Skates were thin ice. Don't know what's going to get dinged next. So 2 months ago was okay. Took it all down. Not an easy decision to make. Took those lessons learned, incorporated it into here now. So that is one reason you may want to watch for the interesting sports analysis. Because I do try to make that a point. Because there's a little bit more of that than the sports highlights. But the sports highlights that you end up with or a little bit longer, that's the benefit. It's not one of those 1 to 2 minute bits that are all over YouTube and, you know, what I would like to call from the category, why bother? You like to put together, as I said, a vignette that makes sense, whether it's towards the end so you can see how something ended, or from quarter one, set one, to the last so you can see how it evolved in a quick and easy to discern what's going on order. All right, so now I'm going to sound like Tank Neal's operator. You're supposed to go through all this boring program software and stuff. I do have notes here, but sometimes I accidentally talk wrong. My legal disclaimers can be like, combat training. OMSR's This show is copyrighted to the OMSR. Brief video highlights courtesy to NBC and the ILCB. OMSR does not own these videos, but does own all the original content and the overall concept herein, most rights reserved. And we have a strict set of principles that we adhere to, people's privacy, not being too mean-spirited, so forth. But key among those are three premises to the DCA or the DMCA, Digital Copyright Act. And these are fair use standard, derivatives, and a minority use. You could also say that there's no money being exchanged because the OMSR is a pro bono production. And this was all hashed out through WIPO, World Intellectual Property Organization. So that covers us, and enough with the Law 101 boring stuff. Let's get to it. All right, so today's subject, we're talking boxing final, Laila Ali's interview, your commentary at the studio about how Team USA can do better in the future, and then that little funny short they did at Clemente Russo's expense. Hey, you know, he may think he's a boxer, and I even may think so, but the rest of us saw it. He brought it on himself. Does he really think that's a good boxer? Okay. So to Laila Ali's interview, that is sort of my life rant, sports rant of the day to carry over from Generation 1. With regard to women's boxing, now, I will say there's no one better and probably no one more well-spoken. And her interview is spot on and has some funny elements to it, but at the beginning when she says that people aren't understanding it because they haven't seen it and they don't know how serious it is, it like makes them ignorant. Well, it's kind of like, I don't need to go to a full-on the Kumite to know that that's taking martial arts to the extreme. And that does exist, by the way. Or it's kind of analogous, but not directly correlatable. Like, you don't need to go to a cockfight to know that, you know, that's not appropriate. No matter what, how they try to, oh, the chickens never get hurt, right? And there's just some things women are not built to be doing. Football, boxing, coal mining, things of this nature. She said, well, we're not trying to be like men, we're being women, but we're fighting other women. Does that seem very ladylike? You know, it's been said about boxing for decades that it was too violent of a sport, men beating each other's brains out. But it does emulate somewhat the male spirit, not so much the woman's spirit. All right, so enough about that. Her interview, it's funny. She's got some great personality. You'll see that on display. She's definitely a pro-woman. That comes out a couple times. She's just joking. And they made the comparison with basketball to, you know, the difference between women's basketball and the men's being more fundamental. Well, I'm going to go out on a limb here and say, well, that's because the difference between most sports from the male to the female side of things is it's just a little bit more of whatever is going on with men. And most people would say that, except maybe some of your winter sports or the swimming and whatnot. But in terms of basketball, they have to be more fundamental. They're not as tall, can't dunk, most of them, and things of this nature, right? All right, so there's a two-minute warning. This is the last boxing show. Enjoy the highlights, and thanks for watching. So hopefully Team USA could get it together. A funny bit at the end, you know, before the fight, their prediction was spot on between Usyk and Russo, so I couldn't resist showing that. Is the last boxing show. All right, so we'll bid adieu to Eddie. Give a trooper award out to BJ and Fred at the studio. They had some great moments calling all the boxing matches, even though they were watching most of the time, you know, not that great of stuff. Good humor, spot-on commentary, and not too long of their commentary as opposed to Bob Costas. Okay. Later days, and more Olympic plays.
Probably a train of thought in the minds of some that women's boxing, with all due respect, is folly. This is not serious business, and you have women in the ring, and I'm sure there are people that believe they have no reason being in the ring.
Well, I think that people who would think it's not serious are someone that's never seen women's boxing before in the first place, because that's just ignorant. I mean, first of all, we're athletes, just like in every other sport. Every sport is represented with women this year in the Olympics. So women can train, we can fight just as hard as men, but except we fight each other. We're not trying to fight men, we're not trying to be like men. We're being women, but we're fighting. And of course, I think that I've been able to show that with my career. I've seen so many other women do it before me, doing it now, and they're going to see now on the stage of the Olympics. They're going to see what it's really all about.
Well, you're going to knock out a lot of men. It doesn't matter. Well, you probably would have knocked him out anyway.
I go for the knockout because I don't like having to wait and see what the judges are going to do. That's one thing I do not like. It's an uncomfortable feeling, and I'm going to knock you out and make sure I win.
So scoring in the Olympics is going to drive you insane.
Oh, let's not even start with that. Yes. I mean, can you imagine training hard, doing everything you need to do, getting to this level, being in the Olympics, and then having some lopsided score, and that just killing your chances? I just, you know, it's really sad when that happens. In pro boxing or in amateur boxing.
As you have watched boxing, and you see the amateur game is so different than the pro game because you're trying to score points in a certain way, how frustrating is that for somebody who grew up watching professional boxing?
You're talking about to watch amateur boxing?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's really hard because, you know, they're pressing these buttons, and it's like, are your eyes, you know, connecting with your fingers, and you're pressing the right buttons.
And if you look at the difference between the WNBA and the NBA, the WNBA, some would suggest, is more fundamentally sound. The women are playing a fundamental game. What are the major differences between men's and women's boxing?
Women are just fundamentally more sound in all areas of life. So why wouldn't it be in sports as well? But I'm just joking. But
no,
like I was saying, saying, you know, the major difference with men and women's boxing, professionally, women fight 10 championship rounds opposed to 12, and then we fight 2-minute rounds, which is another thing that makes no sense. It's not, 2 minutes is not enough to put the beat down on somebody. I just have to say, I need 3 minutes, 3 minutes, not two. No, joking.
No, you're staying in that bracket. I've seen just one easily. I mean, we all saw that, dominated over Bravo, and yet one of the judges in that last round had it 2-2 score.
Yeah, the judge from Sweden.
Explain that to me.
Judge from Sweden had the biggest disparity. He had it 11-1 for Boxing. But the judge from Korea, and you guys out there watching, just saw that last round between Boxing and Bravo. The judge from Korea had a 2-2 score for that.
Had a lot of success. So it's not only Cuba and Russia and America anymore. There's a lot of other good countries, and it showed off that they showed at these games.
Well, one of the keys when you watch amateur boxing as compared to when you watch professional boxing in the United States, the scoring is so different that you have to be trained exactly and precisely in how to score in amateur boxing.
Yeah, you do, and that's the trick of this whole thing. We are still getting accustomed and familiar with how the points are being scored. These other countries have it a little better than us right now, but with a little time, USA will be right back in it. But there's a lot of good other countries out there that are very talented boxers.
Well, when it's all said and done, the Ukraine will leave with the most men's boxing medals at 5, followed by Cuba, Great Britain, and Russia with 4. Ireland, Kazakhstan, and Italy will have 3. We mentioned the United States, 0. Gusek in the men's division. The United States men captured 1 medal in Beijing. No medals here. Worst performance in Olympic history. Now, the Italians are known as passionate people. Next up in the heavyweight division, we're going to see Clemente Russo of Italy. Without question, Russo is the biggest romantic in the boxing competition. Now, he is not just a fighter. He's a lover as well. In each of Russo's fights, he has employed the love 'em and beat 'em philosophy. Throughout the bout, he embraces his opponent as if he was a relative who had just returned from war. This approach has worked well for Russo up to this point. Let's see how it serves him against Usyk of the Ukraine. You have to look. If you've watched Clemente Russo, you have to admit, it's a highly unusual technique to embrace your opponent, push him away, and punch him when you get an opportunity. It is the most bizarre style in the entire tournament. A lot of people aren't pleased with it, but it has served him well. How will it serve him tomorrow?
You know, I think we need to take this guy to Dancing with the Stars in Italy, because he's just, this guy loves the grab. He loves to get close to his opponent and not give his opponent any chance to score when he gets in close. You know, I personally cannot stand the style of holding and grabbing.
We saw it against
the Azerbaijani guy. We saw it against the Cuban guy. Those were the better fighters in the Italian level. Listen, he's fighting smart. He's fighting how he knows he needs to fight to be successful in this tournament. But you know what? He's not the better fighter in a lot of situations. And I think Usyk today is going to expose that and make sure that he's not allowed to hold his way to another victory.